Preface of Napoleon, A Short Biography. Napoleon, A Short Biography by R. M. Johnston. Preface. This book is intended to present to the reader, in the most concise form possible, but yet with historical accuracy, an outline of the history of Napoleon that will convey an adequate first impression of his genius and policy. Without some knowledge of this extraordinary man and of his period, it is impossible to understand the politics, constitution, and general circumstances of modern Europe. But the literature of the Napoleonic period is so vast, probably approaching 40,000 books, that the reader who feels disposed to get some acquaintance with it is frequently unable to find a practicable way through the maze. It may be said without disparagement to their writers that any one of the three or four best general histories of Napoleon, taken alone, is inadequate to convey a sufficient impression of the man and his times. But to Napoleonic literature as a whole there is no key. A complete bibliography is so vast an undertaking that even the labours of Baron Lambrusso and Herr Kirchesen appear to offer little promise of completion. The latter's select bibliography is the best available guide, but however valuable for the student, some 200 pages of bare bibliographical entries cannot be of great service to those not possessing some previously acquired knowledge. It is part of the purpose of the present work to enable the ordinary reader or the would-be student safely to take a first few steps in Napoleonic literature, avoiding the innumerable books of little or no authority, and getting some sort of notion beforehand of what those here recommended are likely to give him. As to the narrative itself, the desire to attain conciseness, combined with true proportion, presents difficulties and disadvantages, results in unavoidable gaps. Thus no attempt can be made to narrate the numerous military operations of Napoleon on the same scale. Certain campaigns and battles, Wagram, Austerlitz, Waterloo, for instance, have been treated more fully as being of special importance politically or strategically. Others have been passed over with a bare mention, though not without due consideration for the clearness and continuity of the narrative. Where details and anecdotes have been brought in, it has invariably been for the purpose of illustrating broad issues. To furnish a correct outline of Napoleonic history, and to point the way along which it may be profitably pursued, that, and nothing more, is what this book aims at effecting. This new edition is revised to date in the bibliographies, and is corrected in a few typographical and other slips. Its appearance coincides with that of my French Revolution, of which it forms the continuation. Will the reader kindly note, however, that this is not a short history, as that is, but a short biography. The one book contains the other, but in a different key. Cambridge, Massachusetts, April 1909. End of preface.
Chapter 1 of Napoleon, A Short Biography, M.D. Napoleon, A Short Biography, by Robert Matteson Johnston. Chapter 1, Napoleon Before the Revolution. Birth and Childhood, Education, Appearance and Character, The Revolution. In the history of Napoleon Bonaparte, we plunge into the characteristic at the very outset, the date of his birth. He was born either in 1768 or 1769, probably but not certainly in the latter year. As late as in 1796, when he married, the date of his birth was given as February 1768. Later it was fixed at the 15th of August, 1769. This is not a matter of vital importance, yet it is not without interest for two reasons. In the first place, it is typical of Napoleon's methods that he should have placed the celebration of his birthday at the same date as that of the Assumption, which is one associated with rejoicing and merrymaking in all Latin countries. Another interesting point in this connection is that in 1768, the island of Corsica, the home of the Bonapartes, was Genoese. A year later, it was French. If Napoleon was born in 1768, he was born a Genoese. If in 1769, a Frenchman. However this may be, and the point has been the subject of some controversy, it is certain that all the circumstances of his birth and youth left him nearly devoid of what might be described as national traditions or feeling, though in his boyhood he was intensely Corsican. The Bonapartes were a noble but poor family of Italian extraction, settled at Ajaccio, where Charles Bonaparte, Napoleon's father, exercised legal functions under the Genoese government. He took part in the civil wars that preceded Napoleon's birth, in which Paoli became prominent. The Corsican disorders need not be related here. It will suffice to say that Charles Bonaparte transferred his allegiance to France in 1769, when the sovereignty of the island was abandoned by the Genoese. Yet by race, neither he nor his son was a Frenchman. The Genoese were a maritime people. Their home was the Mediterranean. Their standards had been carried in triumph at various periods from the Strait of Gibraltar to the Bosphorus and Constantinople. This is worthy of note, for the boy brought up in the Genoese atmosphere and traditions, who became Emperor of the French, had for many years his eyes and his policy constantly fixed on the Mediterranean. At every stage of his career we find that great inland sea, around which our civilization took its earliest shape, playing an all-important part. Napoleon first crossed it in the year 1779, when his father succeeded in securing his appointment to a free cadetship at the military school of Brienne. Young Bonaparte's school days were not very remarkable. His ignorance of the French language, his lack of fine clothes and fine manners, his innate pride and aloofness kept him solitary. He did not shine in arts and literature, but showed conspicuous ability and quickness in mathematics and geometry. In one other respect he impressed several of his teachers, and that was his strong and domineering temperament. In 1784 he was transferred from Brienne to the Military Academy at Paris, and no sooner was he there than he revealed his force of character even more strongly by drawing up a memorandum exposing the numerous shortcomings of the establishment as a military training school and setting out a scheme for its reformation. This did not tend to make the 15-year-old Corsican popular with those placed over him. How little could they then foresee that he was fated to carry out this and many other even more important reforms within a very few years? He spent only 12 months in Paris and then received his commission as a sub-lieutenant of artillery. 3 years later, the French Revolution broke out, and in 10 years more the Corsican sub-lieutenant of artillery was the ruler of France. What were the causes that brought about this wonderful rise of fortune? Chiefly two: the extraordinary character of the man, the extraordinary character of the circumstances into which he was thrown. Had not those two great factors coincided with such precision, it is quite safe to assume that European history would be without what is perhaps its most wonderful page. It is therefore important, before we go further, to consider the personality of Napoleon, after which a brief view of the origin of the French Revolution must be taken. This will lead us to the events in which the Revolution and the man who was destined to be its heir were both concerned. Napoleon Bonaparte was a short, dark, swarthy man of typical southern appearance. In his early years, until 1805, he was extremely thin. It was not until his face filled out that his features could be pronounced handsome, though his nose was salient and mouth well formed. His hands and feet, like those of his brothers and sisters, were beautifully modeled. His head was large, full, and intellectual. But what produced the greatest impression on all who met him was the brilliancy and imperiousness of his steel-blue eyes. They revealed the volcanic energy of the soul beneath. He was given to violent bursts of temper, the occasional outbreaks of a nearly superhuman mental energy, and of a temperament easily swayed to passion by personal and selfish considerations. He was perhaps the greatest egotist the world has ever seen, with the result that he often applied his indomitable will and magnificent qualities to very low aims. Judged hastily, and by certain traits alone, he might be thought to be little more than contemptible. Thus, in the matter of veracity, he viewed lying from a strictly utilitarian point of view, and always said just what was convenient, so that his history, written from his own statements, would be little better than fiction. He played cards as he conducted warfare, obtaining every advantage he could, legitimate or otherwise. Yet he cannot be called a small man, only a man with small aspects, and if he won by his cheating at cards, he always returned the stakes after the game was over. When found out in his perversions of truth, he was prepared to own up. On one occasion, Metternich stoutly declined to believe some information published in the Moniteur, and at last Napoleon laughed and confessed, Sono bugie per I parigini. They are lies for the Parisians. Alongside of this trait was a wonderful largeness of perception, and many, in fact, have said that it was Napoleon's breadth of view that constituted his genius. It was not so much that as the perfect combination of breadth of view with attention to the most minute detail. His powerful imagination made him see events in their fullest possible extension. As he said himself, he was always living 2 years ahead. At the same time, his instinct for detail was the nightmare of every colonel in the army, of every functionary in the empire. The memoirs of the period are full of anecdotes illustrating this. Philippe de Ségur relates that he was sent on a tour of inspection in which he visited several fortresses, many camps and forts, and numberless earthworks and batteries. On his reporting to the emperor, he was cross-examined at great length, but went through the ordeal with flying colors until at last asked whether at a particular spot on a small crossroad not far from Antwerp, two field pieces were still in position. The brain of Napoleon was like a machine, so perfect, so accurate in its working, but the spirit that impelled it was that of a soldier and a gambler. Logical perception of chances was instantaneous with him and promptly turned into action with perfect audacity and relentless activity. It was among his soldiers that he was happiest, and few anecdotes told of him are more characteristic than that related in the memoirs of a Polish officer who served in the campaign of Russia. Napoleon had just joined headquarters after 3 years of peace and was in the midst of the numerous columns converging on the points at which the Russian frontier was to be crossed. In the middle of the night, the officers of the staff were awakened by an unusual noise. Napoleon was sleepless and was tramping up and down his bedroom singing at the top of his voice the revolutionary marching song, Le Chant du Départ. He was happy once more. He was playing the biggest stake of his life with the biggest army he had ever assembled. It was the satisfaction of the roulette player sitting down at his accustomed chair with a large pile of gold in front of him. But there are yet other aspects of the character of this, the most extraordinary man of modern times, that must not be omitted in attempting to portray him. Making exception of the rhetoric he so frequently used in addressing his soldiers and occasionally in his diplomatic relations, his correspondence constitutes a wonderful intellectual achievement. In the 32 volumes published officially, one might nearly say that there is not a superfluous word, not an embellishment. Conciseness, energy, decision, perception stand out with overpowering force from every page, and it may quite properly be said that the correspondence of Napoleon is a great literary monument. It is safe to predict that it will be read when the names of Chateaubriand, of Delavigne, and Lamartine are well nigh forgotten. His bombast has been alluded to. However distasteful to Anglo-Saxon ears, it often enough produced its due results, inspired his soldiers, terrified his enemies. In nothing was Napoleon more an Italian than in his strong dramatic sense, and his public life from the moment he got his foot on the first rung of the ladder of ambition was one long pose. He did his best to create and to send down to posterity the Napoleonic legend, and even at the present day, when more reasonable views are beginning to prevail, there are many, even among staid historians, who are prepared to accept him at his own valuation. Before closing this brief sketch of his personality, it may be as well to add that a view that seems becoming popular in some quarters at the present day, the view that Napoleon was an epileptic, reposes on very slight evidence. It is possible, just as many other hypotheses are, but on the other hand it is certain, if this theory is accepted, that he was a very slight sufferer, and that no epileptic ever showed greater clearness of intellect. Historically speaking, to say that Napoleon was epileptic is probably untrue, and is certainly irrelevant and misleading. Here, then, in the year 1789, was a young sub-lieutenant of artillery from whom great things might be expected. Yet had not his path crossed that of a great political cataclysm, it is certain that he would never have found the opportunities that enabled him to rise to the level of his genius. The misgovernment and ineptitude of the Bourbons had at last been visited with retribution. Although France was fast increasing in wealth, More than half her people knew the pangs of famine. Many had died of hunger. Montesquieu, Voltaire, Rousseau, Helvetius, Diderot, D'Alembert had stirred the reason of the thinking class. France had within her all the makings of a great modern nation, as was conclusively demonstrated by Napoleon 10 years later. Yet she was degraded by such barbarities as the mutilation and execution of the Chevalier de la Barre, or the attempt to prevent the burial of Voltaire's body. She was brought to bankruptcy by the criminal folly of the court and its ministers. Retribution followed, the revolution broke out, and reaction swung far in the direction of popular absurdities and horrors. From 1789 to 1794, the complete scale of democratic passions was exhausted. The most excellent reforming zeal, the most exalted sentiments of patriotism and disinterestedness, caught in a rising tide, hurried into a whirl of political disintegration, finally disappeared or made way for mob rule, violence, terrorism, suspicion, and anarchy. While in the cities the revolution gradually fell into the hands of gangs of political fanatics or unprincipled ruffians, its best elements found refuge in the armies of the assailed republic. Birth was no longer essential for becoming an officer, and great soldiers like Ney, Masséna, or Murat found their path no longer stopped at the rank of sergeant. Court favor no longer made generals, and a Bonaparte might expect to rise above all his fellows. His first opportunity came in 1793 at the siege of Toulon, but before coming to that, it will be as well briefly to indicate what had occurred previously and since Bonaparte had entered the army. Chronology: 1261, earliest Bonaparte at Florence. 1529, Bonaparte's go to Corsica. 15th August 1769, Napoleon Bonaparte born. April 1779, he goes to school at Brienne. October 1784, proceeds to Military Academy, Paris. August 1785, sub-lieutenant of artillery. 14th July 1789, capture of the Bastille, French Revolution. End of chapter 1.
Chapter 2 of Napoleon, A Short Biography. Ames, Iowa. Napoleon, A Short Biography by R. M. Johnston. Chapter 2. Toulon and Vendémiaire. Bonaparte and Corsica. Siege of Toulon. The Terror. Vendémiaire. Marriage of Napoleon and Josephine Beauharnais. Army of Italy. Tactics and Strategy in 1796. From 1789 until 1793, during, that is, the first 4 years of the Revolution, Bonaparte was striving to improve his prospects in connection with Corsican affairs. He paid several visits to the island, joined the French Democratic Party, but could not succeed either in securing the victory of that party at Ajaccio or in bringing to a favorable end a small military expedition he led into Sardinia. In the course of these intrigues and proceedings, we catch an interesting glimpse of him noted by his school friend Bourrienne during a short stay in Paris. The young Corsican officer, whose watch was in pawn and whose dinners were generally provided by his friends, saw, among other sights, the march of a mob of 500 men to the Tuileries, and Louis XVI complying with their orders by appearing at a window wearing a red Phrygian cap. Bonaparte was deeply moved at this spectacle, and declared with indignation that with a couple of guns he could have dispersed all the scum of the faubourgs and taught them a lesson they would never have forgotten. The doings of Bonaparte at this period have no large bearing on history and are in part somewhat obscure. But after the final failure of the French party in Corsica, he returned to his occupation as an officer of artillery, serving now in the rank of captain, 1793. In August of the same year, the French Republic, assailed on every side, received a severe blow by the inhabitants of Toulon proclaiming the king and calling to their help an Anglo-Spanish fleet. The government immediately sent troops to attempt the recapture of the fortress, and Bonaparte found himself in command of the small force of artillery collected. His skill and judgment quickly won recognition, and he was soon promoted to the functions of a lieutenant colonel. His energy made feasible the only plan that promised success. It consisted in capturing one of the English positions, the Fort de l'Aiguillette, whence the bay and shipping could be commanded. Bonaparte pressed forward the work, but the British fire was severe and the guns of his battery were silenced. He then had recourse to his knowledge of human nature and of the French soldier. A large sign was posted, "This is the battery of the men without fear," and a call was made for volunteers. This was well responded to. Some severe fighting ensued. Finally, the British position was breached and stormed. As Bonaparte had foreseen, this success of the French entailed the immediate evacuation of Toulon by the Anglo-Spanish forces. Thus Bonaparte won his first reputation, and before many months passed, his services were recognized by promotion to the rank of Brigadier General. It was at the period we have now reached that the revolution attained its extreme of violence. The government of France had been seized by the Jacobin Club and Robespierre. An enthusiastic conformity to their doctrines appeared the only means of escaping the guillotine. Bonaparte, like nearly every other officer of the French army, made show of zeal in support of the terrorists, and was during some months on close terms with Robespierre Jeune. But in Thermidor, July of 1794, the Jacobin tyranny was broken, and in the reaction that followed, Bonaparte was for a few weeks placed under arrest. After his release, having thrown up his command in the Southern Army, he went to Paris, where he probably hoped to find some opportunity of advancement in the turmoil of politics. That opportunity was slow in coming, but he refused the command of a brigade of infantry in the Army of the West rather than leave the capital. At last, in the autumn of 1795, events took place that marked his first step forward in the political world. Since the fall of Robespierre in 1794, a strong movement of reaction had taken place in the capital, partly royalist, wholly conservative. Most of the sections of Paris were hostile to the convention, which aimed at retaining power under a newly framed constitution. And as each section had its battalion of National Guards, the movement soon took an insurrectional and menacing aspect. The executive power of the Republic was to be vested in a committee of five, the Directoire, among the members of which was Barras, who, as a representative of the government, had known Bonaparte at Toulon and had been struck by his talents. In the last days of September 1795, the movement of the sections became more pronounced, the symptoms of an approaching storm more clear, and the convention charged Barras with its defense and with the command of all the troops in Paris. But Barras was a civilian and needed military assistance. He therefore called to his aid several generals then in the capital. Among them was Bonaparte, who accepted, though not without hesitation. His personality, his decision and promptitude completely turned the scale. At this point, we may pause for one moment to recall an anecdote of those days that is eminently characteristic of the man. Thiebault, a young officer, reported at headquarters and found the newly appointed general seated at a table in conversation. He appeared small, of poor physique, with long, lanky hair and a shabby uniform. He was asking questions of the most elementary character of officers of far greater experience and seniority in military administration. There was an inclination among some of those present to smile at the ignorance displayed by the newcomer, but Thiebault admired his complete absence of false pride, the searching character of his inquiries, and the rapidity with which he appeared to assimilate the information he acquired. The officers placed under his command were certainly not inclined to think lightly of him for long. On the 13th of Vendémiaire, the revolt came to a head, and the sections prepared to march against the assembly. Bonaparte seized all the available artillery, owing to the promptitude of a major of cavalry, Murat by name. The few thousand troops available were concentrated about the Tuileries, and as soon as the National Guards began their movement, Bonaparte opened with grape along the streets leading to his central position. There was considerable bloodshed, but the insurrection collapsed immediately, as must all insurrections treated in that prompt and uncompromising way. Bonaparte's second successful demonstration of his knowledge of the theory and practice of artillery received large recognition, for he was shortly afterwards appointed to the command of the Army of the Interior. He was now a rising man in the state, and for this reason succeeded in winning the hand of a lady of rank and beauty to whom he had been paying his attentions for some months. Josephine Tacher de la Pagerie was a beautiful Creole who had married the Vicomte de Beauharnais, an officer in the French service, by whom she had two children, Eugène and Hortense. Beauharnais fought for the Republic, was unsuccessful, and went to the guillotine one of the last victims of the Reign of Terror. His widow became one of the beauties of the new fashionable society that centered about the dissipated Barras and his wife. Whether she loved Bonaparte is very doubtful, but it is clear that she felt his magnetic power, and when it was decided that he was to have the command of one of the armies on the frontier, she married him. The marriage took place on the 11th of March 1796, and on the 21st Bonaparte started for Nice to assume command of the army of Italy. It appears not improbable that Josephine's influence with the Barras had been largely instrumental in securing this important appointment. We now have come to the beginning of Napoleon's career as a commander-in-chief, and since his history must be essentially military, since he remains without question the greatest soldier concerning whom we have accurate information, it will be well to examine at this point, before we follow him into Italy, what was actually represented by a movement of troops or a battle in his time. To speak of an advance or retreat of a right or left wing, or of a movement resulting in so many thousands being killed, wounded, or taken prisoners, conveys but the vaguest notion of the evolutions actually carried out. When considering the history of the greatest of captains, it will not be out of place to take a preliminary view of the tactics and strategy of his day, and to attempt to convey some more precise impression of the actual occurrences of the battlefield. When the French Revolution broke out, the art of war was as much trammeled by narrow regulations as was that of letters. The methods and traditions were those of Frederick the Great, but dogmatism had supplanted genius. Rigidity of discipline and tactical formalism were the foundation of the system. The soldier was a brutalized individual, skilled in multitudinous attitudes and formations, fighting like a machine under the inspiration of constant floggings. Two opposing lines of infantry, each formed on a depth of two or three ranks, would advance nearer and nearer to each other in the most perfect alignment, every musket even, every toe turned to the same angle. when within firing distance, the one whose discipline was the more rigid would generally manage to survive the two or three mechanical volleys that would be exchanged at a range of 50 to 120 yards. With regiments thus drilled, the great aim of every commander was to attain tactical perfection, and the conduct of a battlefield became slow and artificial. War was turned into a scientific game with arbitrary rules. France revolutionized war as she had every political and social observance. With promotion thrown open to every soldier, with the doctrine of liberty, equality, fraternity proclaimed, with many of the old officers leaving the country, it became impossible to maintain discipline, and in many of the early battles of the Republic, the French army suffered in consequence. The convention declared that corporal punishment should not be inflicted on free men. The sentiment was to its honor, but the army was soon reduced to chaotic conditions. From these conditions arose a new army, bolder and greater than the old. It was inspired by ardent patriotism, that finest of all the military virtues, and made up in dash, intelligence, and courage what it lacked in science. From these circumstances a new system of tactics was evolved, of which the most characteristic innovation may be understood by the following convenient illustration. A body of men marching along a road will naturally form a column, say 4 abreast. Suppose such a column arrives near a village occupied by the enemy and attempts to take it. What is the simplest, least scientific manner in which this might be accomplished? In the first place, the most raw of officers and inexperienced of troops would quickly learn to double up so as to convert a front of 4 into a front of 8. Then a quick dash, the bayonet, the pressure of the rear ranks on the first, would do the rest. This was, in its roughest form, the usual French system of attack during the wars of the Republic and Empire.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.